music, readings, experiments, just be open to it, enjoy. And then after that, Karuna Shinsho will have a moderated talk for about 20, 30 minutes with everyone, and then happy to chat with anyone after. But thank you so much for being here, and thank you all for bringing your amazing stuff to the stage. Love it. All right.
والحق الم A wedding? Because all I got was a phone call 5 months ago, a voicemail after 3 years of waiting, 3.5 years of planning, telling me you changed your mind. So why should I believe anything you say to me right now? They find out how long I've been here, I won't be allowed back for another 10 fucking years. We came here legal, but we didn't stay here legal, we overstayed, so I'm a fucking criminal, according to here. So please, please don't bring it up. Please do not do that to me again. Unless you're sure. Felt like I had a key. The key in my hands. I have never felt that before in my entire life. There were things I was finally able to really imagine for myself. I was gonna join the world I live in. The world you got to live in for 3.5 years. And then you called. I've had to rely on other people, in hiding, and secrets for the last 13 years of my life, for just basic human and illegal. All of it. All of it's been illegal. I went to school illegally. I learned illegally. I walk the streets illegally. I literally am. When I'm walking, I am illegally walking. Walking is illegal because I didn't get some paper means I cannot be a full person here. And you'll go ahead with this? With all of it?
Adrift by Balfi. A shipping container of rubber duckies made in China for the US washed overboard in 1992, and some of them traveled and washed ashore over 17,000 miles over 15 years. Let's go ahead and assume it's yellow. What little of science I know. Its plastic skin invincible against salt water, but not the sun. It can only ask so much. Will it fade or brown? What I mean to say is, I would want one of these for my daughter. Its internal clock set to the mercy of the currents that have been predictable for centuries. But mercy is not the word anyone would choose. Sometimes not making sense and floating are the same thing. Each wave is its own beginning and ending. Through international waters, we could have caused an incident. No one knowing you, never reaching the hands that hoped for you. Rough immigrant or free refugee. Floating flagless, fading border, stamped with words. But not the name. Thank you.
drugs? Do you sell drugs? You sell drugs. What kind of drugs? Where do you live? Where are you from? Where's home? What's in the bag? How long have you been in the United States? How long were you in Canada? What were you doing there? What are you doing? What do you do for work? Are you poor? What are you bringing with you? Isn't that what famous people like? Are you famous? What's in the bag? Step back, please! I don't need you to sit. I don't need you to come with me. You have one chance to tell the truth. You're lying to me. You think I'm stupid? How much money do you make? What do you do for work? You sell drugs. What do you want out of life? Who do you love? Where do you want to be? What's in the bag? What's in the bag? What's your flight number? How do you feel about jail time? If I go to a party, a big party with lots of rich people, and they're drinking champagne, and you got sexy ladies there and everything, and there's cocaine, and you buy some because, hey, you're having a good time, and then you go to the bathroom, and you take a shit, and I ask you what you did last night, and you told me you took a shit, would you be lying? No! But do I care whether you took a shit or not? No, I care about the cocaine! Calm down, listen, listen, you have two options. You can either see a judge in the morning, or I can let you go, okay? You want to be locked up? You're looking at it a few years ago, yeah. Who knows? It's not up to me. You just gotta admit that you made a mistake. You made a mistake. You know you made a mistake, right? You made a mistake. Are you a man? Have you ever been arrested? Have you ever been charged with a crime? What kind of criminal are you? What kind of last name is that? Citizen of? Citizen of? Please go through that door. Please go through this corridor. Take this folder and head straight through there. Do you have a good job? Who are you bringing with you? Do you work? Are you working? Are you lazy? Are you liberal? Are you like sports? Do you think she's hot? Do you think you're getting out of here today? Do you think you can just do whatever you want? Where do you live? Where do you think you live? Where do you think you are? Who do you think you are? You're what? You do what? Hold on! Hold on! Hold on! I'm trying to understand. Let me get this straight. So you're lying to me. Look at you! Look at you! You think that you no, no, I'm talking! What does your dad do for work? What's in the bag? Do you have any credit cards? Will you be a public charge? Are you going to be poor? Why are you poor, you dumb bitch? What are your plans for the weekend? What are you bringing in with you? Put your thumb here, look at the camera. Eyes up. Step over there. Can I see that? What's this? Can you open this? Can you explain this? What's this? Can you explain this? Explain this. Explain this. Explain this. Explain this. Explain this. Explain this. Stand here, please.
Take two. Okay, so you leave your cell phone behind. You can't bring it with you. You can't bring anything except your clothes and your folder of documents. You check your pockets for any foreign objects. Get it? Every time I go to a USCIS facility, it's dismal outside. It's really, really dark and gloomy. You enter an office building, usually it's just some generic concrete office building downtown. You go down a set of generic stairs, past the generic door, and into a generic hallway, where there is a single vending machine and then a bunch of locked doors, a couple stories below the street level. You're totally alone. The walls and floor tile are sleepy faded creams with dark brown rubber baseboards, and you can't tell if it's clean or if it's dirty, and you're unsure if you're supposed to be there. There's an elevator at the end of this hall. You go to it, press the button, and there's some grinding noises. After about 2 minutes, the doors open, and you step into the car. It feels old, and the clear plastic floor indicators have seemed to sour into translucence as they light up one by one, until floor six. At which point, there are no more floor indicators, but the elevator keeps going. For another minute or so. You really can't tell how fast they're going, or how slow they're going. It stops, and then you wait a little more. The door is open, and you're in a generic waiting area with a few generic security guards. You recognize the aura of spit-and-tape bureaucracy, the feeling that nobody wants to help you, and that this process is on the verge of being completely abandoned. That you could possibly wait forever for a procedure that no longer exists. Here and there in the seats are people who seem fearful, some of them angry, some of them deadened. Not many of them are white. Someone comes from another corridor, openly weeping, holding maybe the mother or their older sister. The security guard tells you to take that number, and then the officers yell them from behind cloudy plastic barriers. You clutch your generic folder of documents, which are several dozen photos of you and your partner at a beach in Italy on an awkward date, eating Persian food, standing with family, moving into a new apartment in a hospital.
I grew up hearing all sorts of stories about the world of the grid, this beacon of order. Despite its hollowness, it's a powerhouse of energy, a vessel of any shape. It carries us and it provides us access to different grids. I should tell you about the story of how I came to land on my grid. It was less of a landing and more of a glitch, actually. I've always woken up to the sound of a cuckoo clock in the corridor. It was a motherfucker of a sound to wake up to. One random Tuesday, when I decided to wake up earlier, that day was the day that I witnessed the cuckoo bird of the clock break its head on its way, bursting out right before my very eyes, rendering the little messenger headless. So I watched its head roll towards my feet. And it said, collect yourself. And so I did. I collected myself and I left everything behind except my mirror and the cuckoo clock, of course. Mirror facing clock with me in the middle is how I glitched my way into the grid. The perfect starter kit. Clock at 6:07. Opens up its hand, reaches out to mine, and I travel. I visit other grids, and I visit other shapeshifters like myself. I also am a collector. I collect gear. I engineer it over my corporeal body, and I specialize in exchanging it with other shifters in need. In return, I take back the parts that look nothing like me. I wear them till they become me, and I exchange them again. I am not escaping. I like the grids. I like other grids. I just refuse to accept the role of the struggling shapeshifter. lost light and energy a long time ago. They can't recognize me or my shapes. But I kept a lot of their gear and gave them my cellular modulator. My loved ones, they can still see, but Clock's hand stopped reaching out to send me there, and I also kept a lot of their gear. They kept my memory cards. The last grid I visited was a Shinsho. My friend lost his eyes, ears, and fingertips right before mine. I felt like I was talking to myself. I forgot about the gear and couldn't exchange anything at all. So I have successfully navigated all of the unrealistic expectations of an androgenoid in our society. And I now welcome the headless messenger once again. I want to know where I am. You lost all power. Hold your breath through your wounds. Look gently with your inner eye. Don't try to grab on to anything. Touch has left your fingertips. You've been floating around with eyes, ears, and fingertips flailing everywhere. The spores in the water destroy your 2 meters of skin. This much time. You're a bacterial infection contaminating the water for everyone. For the passersby. But they can always swim back to land and jump back in. They always jump back in. You demanded to keep control over your own state of mind. But your anger got heavier than your chest. Your gills. Wounds and your head has not yet risen above the surface. What did you think would rise from beneath your feet? Rise over the water. You were always told one thing. Land. I hope you know what that means by
So this just wanted to give you a little bit of a context about this piece. So this is from a musical that I've been working on since last year, and this is one of the new songs that I have written, and it's very fresh. This is the first time I'm ever playing to anywhere, and I'm excited about it. So. Thank you.
I was 16. The girls, they called him unsinkable.
Figure out maybe an O1, which is an artist's visa, I'm sure they will talk about. sign a piece of paper that said I was trying to enter legally, and then I was banned for 2 years. And my partner was in the audience. and I shared an apartment with other people at the time, and all that was just locked for me. So I had to stay in my home country for those 2 years. Terry didn't visit me. And eventually, I tried to do an O-1. I tried twice. Both times were declined. I think my lawyer wasn't good enough. And I didn't want to shell out for a really expensive one at the time. Eventually, we found it so hard to visit. We were trying to visit each other like every 2 months. And this was a 5-year period where I was in Toronto and Terry was in New York. That we decided to get married so that we could actually just have a relationship. So we did, got married in Toronto at City Hall, and it took about 3 years after that of waiting, 3.5 years, to get my green card. And I did, and here I am.
While you're waiting for it, you couldn't work, right?
I had to be in Toronto, so I couldn't be here at all, because I couldn't work here. No, so we had to stay separate while I was waiting.
All right, Rawya. So I arrived here 5 years ago with my partner, who had a job at university. I was on a B4 visa, which meant that I was a dependent. I couldn't work. And what happened is I was at a party, and I was telling a story about how I spent to these lawyers, how I spent 4 years in Lebanon, in court, fighting a censorship case. Mm-hmm. And I was explaining to them the trouble about communicating with people who usually do the interrogation, I believe that we do use the same vocab, but we don't have the same definition maybe of that vocab. So it's very hard to communicate with somebody who's interrogating you. For some reason, they refuse to understand what you're saying. And I had spent 4 years going from one court to the other because of a show that we did. They tried to pin a prostitution a case on us, but there was nothing. So they were like, oh, this is, they say, in French, they call it atteinte à la morale. It's when you do something that is that obnoxious that infringes the morality, the general morality of what we did. And I was like proud of myself because after 4 years we were acquitted, and they made me sign a paper that says I would never go on stage and pretend to sell people. So I was proud of myself because 4 years later, I did a show, and I went in every street in Lebanon with a guy in a box pretending to sell him. I was like, yeah, tell me that story, and these lawyers were like, listen, what's going on with your papers? I was like, you know, I can't do much. I'm like, I'm not working. They're like, how about we take your case pro bono? And I'm just going to share the name of this law firm right now, and I have their contact, and they do take... they have an application that's always open for artists who come from countries that might have experienced censorship, or people who might be coming from countries that are at risk. Like right now, they have this big campaign for people from Ukraine. They have a big project for people from Venezuela. So they're always working with artists. They're called Sefi and Mizrahi. I have their contact if anybody needs this. And they were like very efficient. They got me a work visa, and sometime later I got my green card. John?
Hello, hi, I'm John. I came here from Turkey to study musical theater, and after that I wanted to stay in this country, and then after graduating, it was a little bit of a figuring out if I wanted to go to military service, go back home, because we have military service in Turkey, or I had to find a way to stay in this country, so I wanted to audition for grad schools to gain more time for myself, and that's what I've done. And during my grad school education, I've done a lot of writing that was included in the part of it. And for my thesis, I had to write a one-person show. And that actually opened up a whole another world for me, which I had no idea that, because I came here to become an actor, but I didn't know that also there was a writer in me. And so that became actually the main focus of my life, because once I came into this country, I knew that I wanted to. I had to stay in this country because I was gay and I couldn't have the chance to be back home, and that was a very pretty difficult situation. So I knew that the moment that I came here, I had to get the visa. So I was always in the back of my head to find some ways to do that. So after I wrote my show and I performed it in South Carolina, which was a very gay and Muslim show, and it was just like very obnoxious. People walked out of the show, which was perfect for me. And then I was like, okay, I need to, because I lived in New York before, so I wanted to come back to New York and do more of that. So after graduating, I had my 1 year work permission, which was OPT, and then I stayed in New York, and then I just submitted my work anywhere I could find, anywhere who would take me, basically. And then that just actually started to pick up, and then I would just write and perform and write and perform and write. So I had basically like a year of doing shows, maybe like 8 different shows, so that I could prove myself that I could stay here. And there was a lawyer that I was working with who thought that my case was not gonna work. So she dropped me in the middle of, we were in the middle of working together. So, and then that was also the time that I was also trying to reach out to other artists from Turkey, other, you know, artists who are also dealing with the situation of like trying to get a visa. So in one of my shows, I invited one of the other Turkish artists that I knew who also went through the same process, and then she came to see my show. And after the show, she was like, so what's going on with your visa situation? So is there anything I can help you with? And I told her about how the lawyer dropped me and all that stuff. So then she gave me her contact information of her lawyer, who was also Turkish. So that kind of helped a little bit. And so then we started just working on the case and all the documentation, and I reached out to all the theaters that I had relationships with, and, you know, including Theresa, and the break was very supportive, and which I'm always very grateful. And then at the end of it, I got my O1 after my application.
So halfway through the panel, I hear this common theme of lawyers. Sounds like a lot of money, and
yeah.
Okay, let's hear Hanji's story.
Yeah, you guys have really like dire circumstances. I feel mine was like hard, but not too good. no, so I've been in New York for 8 years now. I came to New York for school, and at the end, same, you guys had the OBT visa, which you actually worked within the industry for a year, and then applied for an O1. That in itself was an ordeal. And the first application I made was back in 2020, really like the month of lockdown, 2020, whatever year that was. That first application got denied. I resubmitted the same application with no changes whatsoever the following March, and it got approved. and it got approved. That was 2021, and then actually the whole, like, once you get approved by the government, you have to go to the embassy to get the visa itself. And because I'm a British national, and it was also in the middle of lockdown, I couldn't go to a British embassy to get the visa itself. So I ended up going to Madrid, because it was the closest embassy that was still functioning in COVID during lockdown. And I go to Madrid, they have the government approved letter in their hand, and the officer says, you don't qualify for the visa today. And I'm like, wait, you have the approval in your hand, why don't I qualify? Would not give me an answer. So then I spiral a little bit more,
here in lockdown, and then eventually end up going to Singapore, which is where I was born. I go to Singapore to get the visa against my lawyer's wishes. I go there as the best embassy experience I've ever had. I'll never go anywhere else. They approved it, like, walk in at 9 a.m. and out 20 minutes later, and the embassy officer was like, yeah, all done, no worries, you'll get your passport back tomorrow. So anticlimactic. So I got approved for milestone, so I have another 8 months left on the one before I go for my second cycle. Yeah.
Lianne? Yes. So I am one of the super, super privileged ones. I literally won the lottery.
Oh.
Until then, though, you had a journey.
Yes, my family had applied for it such a long time ago that I think we had forgotten that we may be expecting a green card. We had plans to fly just as a visit visa. We were actually getting ready to prepare the visit visa when, after we went there and came back and spent money, we got news that we actually had been chosen for the green card lottery, and then we got to go do that all over again for a couple of years. My family chose to move before I did. I stayed back in Beirut for an extra year because I thought I could. And Trump had just gone in office, and I was like, but no, it was crazy of me to have stayed when I have a green card. So I picked up and moved, but my immigration chronicles blew up a little bit more after I decided I'm not going to travel to Beirut every 6 months. I'm going to stay here in America and get connected and feel settled. And that was 2019. And it just so happened that the 4 years after 2019 were the most difficult and traumatic years in Lebanon's recent history. And I watched it through my phone. And I would say this was my difficulty in just being here and understanding what I'm doing, but actually all of the bureaucratic processes were they were easy, they were breezy.
So each of you have your own special journey, obviously, some more fortunate than others. So, you know, now you're here, you have your visa, and you can now, hindsight is 2020. Through your skit, I kind of feel that you went through a lot of hell. Do you feel like you would have done anything differently? I mean, it feels like it can also depend, it's a very subjective thing, it can depend on the person that's interviewing you.
Yeah.
So how has this whole process affected you, and what would you have done differently if you would?
Yeah, I mean, on a personal level, I think the waiting in my life, the waiting, like, oh, I'll get it in six months, I wouldn't do that. I think I would say it could come 10 years, so I need to, like, kind of dig into my life as it is, and then make plans if it happens, because I think there was a period where in waiting for so long, things were wrong. On an obvious note, I think I had, like, a lot of entanglement in, like, my thinking about the terms of like not understanding state power and, like, you know, what happens when a state wants to protect its border and use your rights. Like, I approached it kind of cavalierly, and I didn't make, like, serious plans for if something went wrong. So to my younger self, I would have said, like, you know, take it really seriously, the deadlines, and, like, take it very seriously how you approach the border. And now I do. Now that I have a green card, I'm back in entitled mode where I know that I am protected by a certain kind of right. But before then, when I was going back and forth, I had a lot of, like, I don't like this, this is not good, I think. But I had a lot of respect for, like, the ways that I had to navigate around a border situation different than the rest of my life as a citizen. And yeah, I would tell myself to be more careful, I guess.
Why? I mean, I have been through different, like, I've been through bureaucracy in Europe. I have to admit, this is easier. The US is much easier. Europe is like, doesn't it? But there are things that might happen. Like, personally, I took it very seriously because I wasn't young when I came. I went around finding every time I was, somebody quoted me in anything, on any whatever newspaper, in whatever corner, in whatever paper, in whatever moment, anything that had my mention. Because I went and asked a friend, how should I go about it? That's the thing, they don't tell you exactly what they want from you. You have to guess, which ends up being everything. So okay, this is everything I have, and my friend was very straightforward. He was like, listen, Rawya, I don't think they read through it, but I'm sure they weigh it. So just keep adding stuff to it.
The thicker the better.
Yeah, the thicker the better. So I was like, okay, and I went and started adding stuff, started collecting stuff from everywhere. When I went to the embassy, I was very worried in Beirut because, you know, I had had experiences with the American embassy throughout my life. And it was the first time where I was entering it. So I entered it and I remember my partner was like, no eye contact. No eye contact with anyone. And in fact, this is how I got away with it. I entered and I stayed like this. And the person who went through the paper, and the obnoxious security people, who are most of them Lebanese, one of them is like, hey, you good looking, whatever, and okay, I'm not gonna answer. I contained myself from all these little aggressions. And it feels to me that these embassies do that to test us. They want to see if we can take it. If you can keep that mouth shut throughout this process, you might go there and you have to learn to keep your mouth shut too. So that was the process. And then here I got lucky, as I said, with these lawyers and they did help us a lot. They helped both of us actually. They ended up taking the whole thing. They do that. And it was still Trump, and then we got a call and they said, you got your work permit, and we were like, oh, it's the lockdown, but still, I mean, it's a good thing. And a year later, we got the green card, which was completely magical, because I have friends who have been here for 12 years, who are still renewing O-1 visas. It was like this, and it feels like, because I was asking several of my friends, and it feels like if your thing gets stuck somewhere, it might stay stuck for a long time. So, and you might not know exactly what is it about it that is making it stuck, but yeah.
John?
I feel like I agree with all that. Show should have like a warning for people who've gone through conversations at embassies and like to just watch it. I think it's something like, in terms of the question, I don't think there's anything I would have done. I mean, I guess if I lived through it, I think I would just like try working harder. It's just that I think I was one of the lucky ones in terms of knowing what I had to do, because my situation was so, to me, it was like a life or death kind of a deal. So like, I was like, I have to stay here. So to me, from the moment that I took a step into New York, I was looking forward for like ways to get myself to stay here. So and then I was lucky to actually found my way writing, and it was about myself, and it was about my own story, it was about my own experiences. So that's one of the things about the O-1, what makes you special, what makes you unique, what can you do that no one else can does. So I actually luckily found that path for myself already while I was here, so that was actually very helpful. But I think there is some sort of like a magical aspect of like having those embassy moments and like you just like basically submit everything and then let everything unlock just to happen if it happens. So like my experience with the embassy was like when you get your approval, you have to leave the country, go somewhere else, and go to an embassy there and apply in person to get interviewed. So once I went there, I was in line. I was just actually kind of also a little bit lucky about that too, because like there was this person who saw my application and he was like, oh, what do you do? So are you famous? So like those questions which they ask, because it's a visa that Daniel Radcliffe and like Daniel Craig are also all in. It's the same visa. But then he just stood silent, and I was like, okay, so what's going on? And he was like, okay, I can't, I'm just looking for your through your things, and I was just like standing there. And then he said, oh, I'm sorry, I'm just like, so who's your particular? But he just kept asking me like random questions, and I was so thrown off, and I felt really horrible because I'm like, am I answering these questions right? And then there was another silence. And another person was getting rejected on the left side, hand side of me, as I'm hearing that she tried to do this like marriage fraud thing, but that she got caught on the spot. Like I'm hearing all this as I'm trying to go through my own experience. And then the person goes on the interviewer is like, oh, I can't find your documentation, so I'm just gonna hold out your passport and we'll let you know. And I was like, oh, okay. So it's, and then I left building, but then I was like, okay, wait, so I went back in, and all the people who were there are Turkish, so I was like, so what's going on? What do I do? And they said, oh, they'll let me know in like 2 days. So it's been 2 days and I didn't hear anything. And it's been 5 days, and then I got an email saying, your passport has been sent to the address that you selected. And I'm like, but I still don't know if I got it or not. So until I went through, I had to like go into the post office, grab my passport, and had to go through the pages. I did not know if I got the visa or not.
Did you get it?
I did. I did. Like it was like the biggest moment, like because you worked so hard for this, and then you go through that, and you're like, oh, there it is. But at the same time, I heard another friend of mine who's getting interrogated for every single documentation that she submitted to like explain, what did you do there? What was the dates of your performance? Who was there? Who helped you do this? Like, who did this? Who did that? There's so many questions. Because I was lucky that they couldn't find my documentation, that they couldn't ask me anything. My interview was like 2 minutes. So it was lucky, but it was also not. So like, I think there is some sort of a magical aspect of luck that plays a lot in this process. But at the same time, I think what helped me very much during all the things, and going back to the question, is that knowing exactly what I have to do, and basically just like drilling into that direction.
HanJie?
Yeah, no, I fully agree. It's, I actually think it's the whole, it's like, I feel like 10% of your application and 90% luck. Just because of, you know, what you just said and what my own experience as well is like, you know, my application was sent to some random pencil pusher in Vermont who denied it the first time, and then the second time I got approved and saying that, nothing changed. So it's so random. The same with actually getting the visa itself, having to go through that twice and getting it the second time. Like, there's just no rhyme or reason. My advice to my younger self, to anyone who's going through it in the future or now, there's just no rhyme or reason. Like, you just do your best, you just do what you're submitting, what your attorney asks for, submit it, and just it's just like sending it to the void and hoping it comes back with a hoping you get a positive response at the end of it. But yeah, there really is just no there's just no real reason to attend it. I feel like it's a lot of it's just luck.
Yeah. Yes, it is just luck. Actually how it felt like, and I think because of that kind of thinking, and after having spent 4 years away from Beirut watching it all kind of collapse in front of me, had me thinking about my privilege a lot in the context and hierarchy of Lebanese immigrants' privilege. But it got confusing as a person and as an artist to think about the hierarchy of privilege here. It got suffocating. The most time I was feeling like my feelings didn't match my environment, of course. And I had a lot of memory loss. I had this need to get out of survival mode. I needed to make sense of why I'm here and why, what am I seeing? How am I experiencing this through a stream? But I think that it was a matter of urgency to get out of survival mode and to be connected. And it manifested artistically as like, as an actor, I was like in imposter syndrome mode. I couldn't make sense of how to get out of it. But after every crisis kept rolling in, and it was mainly people that got me out of it, really. And changing the way that I listened and understanding not just my privilege, but also the privilege around me, tracing it, figuring out why I'm, in retrospect, putting in all this effort to make sense, tick boxes, shape-shift in certain ways to relay myself in a certain way in the context of being an immigrant, being in all this pain and not seeing the world really feel it. But I think that now a lot of the survivor's guilt dissolved. I think that watching a genocide on my phone of the Palestinian people by the Israeli occupation is also showing me that they're going through what they're going through, and then their guilt is being, there's guilt being enforced onto them, like, no, you should be guilty, and it was familiar.
So some of you had to obviously leave your country and come here, and maybe others, it wasn't as pressing. For example, you know, we think Canada's a pretty modern country, and we would think that many of the cities there have opportunities for artists such as yourself. So why come here, and was it all worth it?
Yes, it was worth it. For many reasons that I'm still discovering, I think I wasn't sure if it was worth it when I got here, and there's a disorientation about whether you made the right choice. You put so much, you kind of feel like you put in a fork in the road and can't go back because you put all this into it. So there's kind of that sunk cost thing. For me, love led the way because I get to be with my partner. And we could have done it the other way around, but it's a choice that we made. And again, once you lock into these long processes, you're locked in. And the other thing I'll say is that, like, I, as a Canadian, someone with like a lot of privilege, and even weirdly, you could say more privilege than an American because of our social services. There was something about being in America as an artist that like felt like I needed to be where like the most, like, this is like controversial for me to say, but like as a Canadian growing up, like America was like the center of evil in a certain way, like the center of empire, and like Canada's like a weird parasite on it. So I was always interested in coming here to kind of confront that more and just figure out what that was a little bit. And I do believe in dual citizenship, so my goal is to have both, and I wanted to be able to be both.
Well, I think we're all international artists here too, right? So you had to come here, obviously. And so how is that, as an international artist here in the United States, and particularly in New York, tell us about that.
I am good with people. And that, to be fair, that year where I couldn't work, 2 years where I couldn't work, I went around and introduced myself to every artist, every theater, every space I could. And I did readings for everyone I met. And whenever I would be invited to a workshop or to whatever, I made sure to be there, which is also an advantage I had because I couldn't work, but some people who can't work because they don't have paper have to go and work. And there are, this is, to be fair, it's a city, New York is a city that is will find a job in the service industry. You will find these theater or spaces that are willing to take you in and to be like, listen, we're not going to pay you now, but you know, you're going to stay with us, and once your papers are going to be here, you will have a job, you will have a place with us. I found a lot of friends, I made a lot of friends and people who were willing to sign me papers that said that I was going to work with them. And that was very helpful. Also, there are festivals that cater for these for immigrants and people who are coming from abroad. So this is always very helpful. Now, when I left Lebanon, the situation had gone so bad that it was obvious that I couldn't go back there. But to be fair, I'm also somebody who works in the performing arts and theater industry, and this is New York. I'm not gonna lie to myself. New York. And it's been delivering. You know, I met some amazing friends. I met some great artists, and I'm still meeting and being blossoming amidst all these amazing artists. And I find this very magical. And it allowed me, just like Lianne said, to just, because if you live under these states of oppression, creativity is, you know, they tell you, oh, you have to suffer to make art. This is not true. Sometimes it happens, but it's not necessarily true for everyone. It's not true for the majority. Few people manage to do it. Good for them, thank you. But no, you need to take distance. You need to have electricity and water, and you need to have access to a certain to art and to creativity to be able to do something. And so this has been really a great opportunity for me still. Although I wasn't in it from the beginning. I was very worried.
So John, you've been an activist for Muslim, gay, immigrant stories as well in your work. How has that been? And you also advise students, right, that you teach down in University of South Carolina?
I've done that.
Okay, so not anymore, but you used to. So yeah. But I'm sure you give advice to a lot of budding artists as well.
Yeah, it's like, it's been very, it's exhausting. It's so much work. It's so, like, everyone sitting here besides you. I feel had to improve so much. And I think that takes away so much from you, because if you ever get yourself in a place where, oh, I have to do all these things to be equal to my college friend who just graduated, could do this like 5 years ago, I am just able to do it. So like that kind of, if you go into that kind of thinking, I think it gets a little like in your head, and you're like, oh, and I could have done that, I could have done this, I could have done that, I could have been this, I could have done that. But I feel like it all happens for a reason. And I feel like we talk about luck, but I think it's always happens the way that it's supposed to be. And if it's like whenever I ever talk to any students or like anyone who comes to me and is like, oh, how did you do it? How can I do it? And what do you tell me is that I try to say that, like, try to find what makes you you. Try to find what makes you special and kind of go for that and try to build on that. And that's difficult, you know. Not everyone always is like, oh, I know what I'm gonna do. I know what I'm supposed to do. This is what I'm supposed to, like, it doesn't work that way. And you don't get to actually have the time to be like, oh, let me just try this and try that and try this and let me find what it actually works for me. But I also always try and say to figure out if you want to stay here or not a little earlier than maybe you should have, or maybe you should have thought, or, you know, I think, but then also that's another difficult thing too. How do you know as a 18, 19 year old who just came to New York for the first time ever in your life, and to to be like, oh, I know this is the place where I'm going to live and make money and work all this and pay all the lawyers and stay here and actually just erase every single thing that I've done back in Turkey or like back in another country and like basically leave all my family there and just like be here for the rest of my life and actually convince them also to be okay with that idea. Like, it's a lot to bear for someone who just comes here for their undergrad education or even grad school. It's heavy, I think. It's difficult, and yeah, and it's like, I think there's a lot of figuring out and like committing that happens. And then once you do that, and then there's a lot of question that comes after, so when do I go home? Do I ever go home? Do I ever work at home? And one of the things that I want to do is to be able to bring what I've done here, what I've seen here, to back home, so that I can show people that you can do this if this is what you want to do. If you can't live in these conditions in this country or anywhere in the world of like where the Muslim population is, and then you're, you know, in one of the you know LGBTQ community and you want to do this, like, it's possible. There are people here, like you said, that are like willing to help you. There are people who will give you a job under the table or any way that you can, or there will be like connections that will happen if you are willing to do that. But at the same time, it's difficult. It's difficult.
HanJie, you had a choice, Asia. You were born and raised in Singapore. You lived in the UK. Why New York?
So I ended up in New York because originally my undergrad degree was in French with psychology in the UK. And in my final year, actually throughout my undergrad, I had been going to auditing classes, auditing theater classes. So throughout my undergrad, I was doing that. In my final year, when I was about to graduate, I auditioned for a place at the drama school in London. Got a place on a master to do a master's, but I don't know, like, training at all whatsoever. But what it was a coincidence because my undergrad college at the time had a sister relationship with Pace University downtown. And so I said, hey, I've got a place at the master's course in London. Would you be willing to send me to New York for a year on an exchange program? Just so I can get some, you know, formal training or whatever in New York, and also I can spend a year in New York. And they said yes, but 6 months in, being in the city, I was like, I can't, like, balance it. Got some, make connections with really good people, and I thought, well, if I'm going to study theater instead of good training as an actor, I might as well just do it in New York, so I'm applied here. That was pretty much it.
Lianne, how about you? You're from originally from Lebanon. Why New York?
It's
the farthest.
Initially, I moved to Texas with my family, and the vast distances and the way I couldn't walk anywhere and get out of my head. It was that. That was a big part of it. But New York is also very hustle and bustle for you. It's very familiar. And I found it familiar, and I made this choice thinking this is where I would thrive the most. And I would definitely say I have. Even though it felt like the loneliest place I'd ever lived, it's the most diverse place I've ever lived. So it's telling. It's telling a lot. Yeah.
How are we on time?
Good.
We've been going on for quite a while. So this is great. I hope everybody got a lot out of today's talk. It just seems like in this world of instability and conflict, all the more it's really necessary to have art, the common language that is devoid of conflict, to bring people together. And so, we need more international artists. Diversity is very important. And thank you so much for making the effort to come here and stay here and create your work and art and share it with everybody here in the world.
Thank you.
And I also say, to add on to what you just said about having international artists, I also think it's really important for companies within the city, theater companies within the city, to be open to helping international artists. Because it's, oftentimes when you just talk to regular Americans about this, they're often so clueless about what's going on. I mean, I just worked on a Broadway show, and the first thing they asked me was, are you a work visa? And then they asked me a bunch of really random documents that they didn't even need to employ me. And, I pay my taxes like everyone else here. All you and a regular American would just provide social security or photo ID, whatever, and that's it. But so many times I've encountered situations where they're asking for more than they actually require, which is like really, really annoying. So I guess the point is really annoying. But my point being, it's really important for companies, anyone really, to be open to helping foreign nationals. Yes, exactly.
Well, thank you to all our panelists. Let's give them a hand.
Thank you.
Theresa, with the Theater, thank you so much for